interesting for the people. And I have tried to put in those things which our research scholars who are aspiring to take up PhD in this domain, they can readily take up. And before going on to this, I want to address one particular thing to all the young researchers here in this forum, okay? So we should understand that domain and technology are two different aspects. Domain and technology are two different aspects. And we should always try to run behind the domain. Research scholars, we should always try to run behind the domain and try to find out the issues in the domain. And then we should address those issues in the domain by using the relevant technology. And it cannot be like being a technocrat or being a computer science professional, you should not search for projects on machine learning and you should try to solve it. So that cannot be the case. So I want to restate this point again, because many of my scholars or many of my students, they come up. Yes. Yes. Any problem, sir?
Sorry, sir.
So many of our scholars, students, and these people, they come and ask, okay, I want to do research in machine learning. Actually, you cannot do a research in machine learning unless otherwise you are a mathematician, okay? So if you're basically a mathematician and you are quite good and strong at the fundamentals of statistics, probability, et cetera, and you have again done your PhD in mathematics or statistics or probability, then yes, you can do a research in machine learning. But a majority or many of the times, computer science engineering graduates, postgraduates, research scholars in computer science domain, it is less likely to have a PhD in machine learning. Rather, they can select a domain. So this is what even I address or advise my students also. So select a domain, not the technology.
Sir, Narendra, sir, sorry to interrupt you, sir.
Yeah.
I think there is some network issue, I think, sir. I mean, you're in the middle.
Oh, it is breaking.
Yes, sir, it is breaking. So if any participant is feeling the same, you can please raise your hand so that even we'll think that it is the same problem.
Actually, here speed is quite good, like 45 to 50 Mbps. Yeah, I will again connect back.
Yes, sir. Huh? No need, sir. Good. I think I'll check mine, sir. No problem, sir. You please continue, sir. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll check mine, sir. No problem, sir.
Okay. So this is what is the thing that I want to give it prior to the start of the session, okay? Then coming to the overview of today's session, it will be basically on the machine learning algorithms. Then what are the steps in implementing these machine learning algorithms for your problem? And what is ML and what are the application domains that we have for the ML? So this is what I was telling, ML and its application domains. Which domain uses what machine learning algorithm or technique or whatsoever next, okay? Then evolving machine learning algorithms, popular machine learning tools and platforms, then the popular AI domains, then few other applications and how they are currently using the machine learning. So this will be a little bit interesting when we go towards the end, but at the start, I have to discuss about few fundas of all these, and then I have to go dive into the deep, okay? Nagendra Garu, am I okay now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now it is okay, sir.
Now,
sir. Sir, Majmuj la cut out almost, sir. Manikam sir, can you hear my voice? Manikam sir.
Yes sir, audible. Your voice is audible.
So my voice is audible. Okay. I think sir has a network issue. I'll help to sort it out, sir. No problem.
Fine. Participant, kindly wait for a few minutes.
Yeah, now is it fine?
Yeah, it is fine now, sir.
Actually, power failure was there, sir. Again, when I was talking, it disconnected. Now I have connected to the hotspot, so okay. It should not be a problem.
Okay, sir.
So once for all, if there is a power back, then again, I will connect back to the Wi-Fi so that there is no issue at all.
Sure, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so this was what we were about, and overview of our session is like this today. So what are the machine learning algorithms, and what are the steps in the implementation of these algorithms? Then what is this ML, and what are the domains, and how they will be solving our problems? Because machine learning is not one simple algorithm or logic that solves all these different types of problems. Different domains, and different domains will definitely have different issues, and different issues are likely to be addressed by the machine learning algorithm in different ways. Of course, different machine learning algorithm for different application domains. Then the next topic will be on the evolving machine learning techniques. Then popular machine learning tools and platforms. Then the AI domains as such. Then discussion will be finally on the applications. How different prominent applications today are using ML to make our life more easy. Okay, so before why these machine learning, I want our participants to understand why is this machine learning our future, and then why we should have what are the skills that we should have to become a machine learning engineer. Okay. So we will hear from Sundar Pichai. Many of you might have heard about his speech. Hello.
Right now audible, sir.
Yeah, my phone is typing, sir.
So why now is
streaming? Yeah, I think there is a network issue from the side.
participant kindly wait for cancel means.
Madam, you can unmute, madam. Any issue? Aruna Kumari, madam.
Hello.
Yeah, yes, madam.
No, the session is not getting come.
There's a break.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Yes, ma'am. Master. Ah, ek hangar le sir. Okay, okay. So there was a small network issue from the speaker side. I request all the participants to hold for 5 minutes. Sir will be again reconnected.
So is this fine now?
Yes, sir, it is fine now, sir.
So I will just play back very shortly now.
There is an issue again, I guess, sir. We are unable to hear your voice, sir. Narendra, sir.
Sir, voice is okay?
Now it is okay, sir.
No, but previously my playback was okay?
No, playback we did not hear, sir, actually.
Was clear?
No, the voice was not clear, sir. Now it is clear.
My voice is okay, but that voice is not okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's not worry about that video. That video is not very important. But what I want to tell you all about is why this particular ML has got prominence in recent days. Okay. It is for one very simple reason that computation power has exceeded very well. And that is what is the major thing that we need to note down. And it is quite good that we should be able to appreciate, because we have a 6 GB or 8 GB phone in your hands now, and it is quite good enough to do any tedious task that our AI or ML can do nowadays. So that is one notable thing that Pichai was talking about in his speech. Okay. And the next one is about the what are the 5 must-have skills to become a computer machine learning engineer. Okay. So this is one aspect. Again, I will not talk about this one, but I will just go through and show you what are the skills that are required. Okay. So the first skill that you require is about mathematics. So mathematics skill set is very, very important. And what is that you require along with mathematics is the probability and statistics. Then along with probability and statistics, you have the linear algebra that we need to know, the matrices. Then along with that, the calculus fundas, integrations, differentiations, because that matters a lot. Then the next one is the programming skill in any given language like Java, Python, C++, etc. Then a good demonstration of programming skills is required. So this is what they are talking about, and the data engineer skills. So this is one requirement that we need to know, like how to handle big or large amount of data. So big data platforms we need to know. Then SQL, then knowledge of machine learning algorithms. So this is next aspect that we need to know. So what is this machine learning? What is supervised? What is unsupervised? So this we need to know. And the next one is on knowledge on machine learning frameworks. So TensorFlow, PyTorch, Scikit. So all these we need to know, Theano, Caffe, Azure. So all these we need to be aware. Okay, so these are the 5 skills that I wanted to highlight. So this video as such is something like a very essential part that we need to know. I felt like these two, they will be the reckoning factors. They will be the factors that we need to think about. Okay, so we will directly go into the next slide, like where I talk about what is this AI and ML for health in COVID-19 situation. Okay, so this is very much important, and this has been projected in detail with the COVID-19 open research challenge, data set challenge. Okay, but we will see how this COVID-19 has been well supported, in the sense how it has come into effect into understanding what is this COVID-19 and what is the part that machine learning has played into COVID-19. So we will understand something like it has provided the data and insights to inform people about safety and economic impacts. So it has given projections. It has given people safety measures that people need to take because of this COVID-19, so many things have slowed down. And this slowdown, no doubt, has impacted everyone's lives. No doubt, okay, everyone's lives it has impacted. In this regard, it has given insights, how things will progress. Again, if somebody asks you, okay, how long will it take to get to normal? It may be your personal career or it may be anything. And you will tell that it may be 6 months, 8 months and all, but at the level of a nation, at the level of a global market, so this AI and ML algorithms, they are able to predict properly how long it will take to recover, okay? And again, for the Indian current economy, prediction is something like Indians have to work 7 days a week. Like that, it has to work for 5 years. So that has been the prediction, 7 days a week, and they have to work for 5 years like that. That too, not 8 hours, for 12 hours they have to work. Then only we will be able to see the effects that have come into Indian way since the March to October or March to July, whatsoever till date. So that impact this ML has been able to identify for Indian share market, Indian job market, Indian finance, etc., etc. So this is one aspect. Then the next aspect is about treatment and diagnostics. So it has been successful in devising the vaccines, whatsoever is the company name it today. It may be Glaxo, it may be our Covaxin, or it may be AstraZeneca, anything for the case. Definitely they should have applied this ML or deep learning technique, whatsoever it is, without which the things they cannot solve it in a smaller time. Because if you look at the previous flu that have happened in last 100 years, till date they have not been able to provide a proper solution till date even. But for COVID-19, yes, there have been many successful trials. There are of course some limitations, but yes, this and all are possible because of today's evolution in ML, okay, machine learning. Then the allocation of resources, including recommendations of allocation of limited assets like hospital space, medical supplies, whatsoever is there. Again, if you look at the example of our national capital, Delhi, today, so the chief minister of Delhi is able to ask for this many beds, XYZ, maybe the digits, okay? It may be 1, 2, 3, or it may be 1,000, or it may be whatsoever is the number of digits. It is not just a number that he comes out roughly, okay? But it is all coming out from the mathematical experts. It is all coming from the machine learning experts. They are not just vague figures, okay? Then the dissemination of accurate information. Again, I forgot to talk about this one also. Again, our Prime Minister has told to devise how to make this vaccine reach to all in India, to plan. Okay, again, we are now planning like what is the supply of the vaccine, then what is the demand, and how which model works out properly. So that is still there, that research is going on. And again, that challenge is open. Even you can post your challenge, you can devise a model, you can devise the mechanism and then post it. So that is still an open challenge from MIT, Ministry of Information Technology in India. Then a scientific research to study and understand COVID-19 situation. So its impacts, what are there. So that and all you are trying to understand using this machine learning techniques and tracking the spread of COVID. Yes, today you are using your Arogya Setu app, but many countries, they use it differently. Maybe the technique will be different, but the app, what it does is same. It keeps track of the contacts, positive contacts, negative contacts, and the combinations, the interactions, So likelihood of being exposed to COVID. So all these things it keeps track. Okay. Now there is a need, like why this machine learning is very much required. Okay. Even for tomorrow, not this calamity. Okay. Let there be an asteroid hitting Earth. Definitely, again, your ML will come into picture and tell you how fast it will come when it is nearing, how slow it will come when it is nearing, how far it will pass away, and what is the gravitational pull. So all these calculations, definitely your ML will help you in all these aspects. Then how is this deep learning and COVID being helped? Okay. So this deep learning is, again, as of all you know, that it is one more extension for this machine learning, and it predicts the COVID-19 surges for next 7 days. So Delhi, for next 7 days, the chief minister is telling like it will come down. Okay. It is because of all these predictions, not just the vague words from his mouth. Okay. Then standard scan. So somebody from Tamil Nadu has claimed, okay, like I can look at the X-ray of the COVID patient who is severely sick. Then I can tell whether he is COVID positive or negative, whether COVID is out or in. So that kind of technology, yes, it is there. Then traditional models in risk stratification. So how patients are in risk, how it is identifying. So that is there. Then drug discovery and vaccine. So deep learning has been one backbone technology for this entire COVID-19 situation. Okay. So this I wanted to discuss so that our people are well aware, like, yes, there is machine learning behind everything, every walk of life today. So there are good opportunities ahead for those people who are good at machine learning. And gone are the days where you routinely code for everything and you expect to write number of pages, like web pages, JavaScript for so many pages, you create blocks. Yes, they are gone now. Now your machine learning will come and do all this block creation, everything. It will do it in a few years, maybe few years, because currently that automation is in progress. Maybe you all of you know that robotic automation is in place, and this robotic automation no doubt can come into contact with this machine learning, and it can deeply immerse themselves and go somewhere. Okay. So this is one topic that I want to reflect here. The robotic process automation and the machine learning, if they twin together, no doubt our software industry will see big booms. Okay. So the topic now is, what is this machine learning and how they learn, how machine learning happens. So they happen in this one of these three categories: supervised, unsupervised, and the reinforcement. Some people talk about the other one, the mixed one. And here only we discuss about these three. Supervised, this supervised, it comes in different forms, like regression solves some types of problems. Decision tree solves some types of problems. Random forest solves some categories. Then classification is one more type. So like that, unsupervised, it is basically on clustering type of problems, association analysis using a priori and FP growth. Then the Markov models. Then the reinforcement model is based on what input that we get, and again, it retrains on the input that we have. But if you look at all these things, we have something called the continuous and the categorical type, okay? This is what we need to understand. What is this continuous and what is this categorical? Okay. So this continuous corresponds to this block that I have ciphered. Then the categorical corresponds to this particular block that I have ciphered here. So what they mean? What they mean actually? So one is the categorical value and the another one is the continuous variable. Okay, so variable is the differentiator there. So categorical variable contains a finite number of categories or distinct groups. So gender, material, and payment method. So there are very few values that you have. And let us suppose male, gender is there, male or female or any other category, only three. Then material type. It may be plastic, metal, or any other material, okay, silica or some other material, three or four, not more. payment method like check, RTGS, NEFT, or whatsoever it is there. Only few, not more. Okay, so that is what is your categorical data. Okay, so variables, they have less possible range of values. The next one is continuous variable, where you have numeric values for those variables assigned, and they have infinite number of values, not just 1, 2, 3, 4, but they have consistently more number of values, like 1.1, if I tell, it can be 1.01, it can be 1.02, so on up to 1.10. So many digits, again 1.001, 1.002, so on up to 1.1, okay? So it may go on like that. That is a continuous variable. Keeping these two variables in our mind, now we need to understand what is this continuous variable and what is this categorical variable. So when I see my data having continuous variables, what I have to use, what type of algorithm I have to use. When I see categorical data, what type of algorithm I have to use. So this can be understood from this particular figure. Okay. Then what are this supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement type learning styles? No, these are not just types of algorithms. Okay, they are the learning styles that your machine learning model will choose to understand what is the domain and what is the solution that I have to provide for that domain. Okay. So supervised is one where the labeled input and output is specified. So it means that for every item that you make an entry into your table or database, you have clearly an output that is specified along with the input. So again, we may get out why or what is the need that I have when I have my input and output specified, okay? So when I specify my input and output along with my data, it gives rise to one feature called the predictability. So that predictability is one aspect which is very well supervised by all these supervised learning algorithms. And they come under different flavors for different values or variables, regression, decision tree, random forest, k nearest neighbors, logistic regression, etc., etc. So this is one type of problem and one learning style. Supervised. Unsupervised, in this type of learning, there is no labeled input data that you have, okay? And we do not have any target or outcome variable to predict, because it is very difficult unless otherwise you know what is the output. You cannot identify what is the next stage. So what we try to do is, we try to segregate all those based on the input values. So this is what we call it as the clustering. Not classification, it is the clustering that we do based on the input values that we have in our hand, because already we don't have the output to exactly predict what they do. So what we observe is, we look into the groups, then we group them and we call it as different clusters. And the examples include the a priori algorithm, k-means algorithm, etc., etc., which we have seen in the last figure itself. So the next one is the reinforcement style. So the machine is trained to make specific decisions. So you will give input output and you will tell this is the decision. Based on this, the machine will start making the same decisions. Okay. So this is as simple as your child or a 3-year-old boy or a 4-year-old boy. You teach him what is right. Okay. And he keeps on growing his the knowledge about the different problems, and he will start dictating about or acting about the same scenario. Like you told something, yes, he will also reflect the same, okay? You show him a 4-legged animal and tell him that it is a dog. Tomorrow he will show you a 4-legged animal and tell that it is a dog, okay? Even though it is a cat, it is another case, okay? So again, parameters coming to effect. You have to tell what are the parameters. So dog, what are the color, what is the color? And for cat, what is the color? What is the size? So what is the tail? What is the head? And how head looks like? So all these things, they come into picture, okay? So this is the thing about reinforcement learning. So this is what I was talking about, the different types of variables earlier. strong hand. And am I audible, sir?
Now it is audible, sir.
Now it is audible. I got a doubt. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the steps in our machine learning. So we have a problem in our hand, and we have the training data in our hand, and we model for a machine learning model. We have a machine learning model that is designed by us. Then they start predicting what is the output for the different training data that you have given. And then you will test it and update it. Like, what is the thing that you will update is basically based on the weights and biases. So the weights and biases, if you are able to tune them properly, they are able to give you a nearest model. So which may underfit or which may exactly fit or which may overfit. Okay, so these three different things may happen. Again, based on your input that you have, that is based on the output that you have after your testing, again, you select the training data in your hand. Again, you try to tune it. So this is why it is like a cycle. Okay, this cycle keeps on looping until unless you find out a proper fit. Okay, not a overfit. Then this is one more slide so that you get a clear picture, like what are machine learning algorithms, what are supervised and what are unsupervised, and what algorithms come under continuous and what algorithms come under categorical. So it is all very simple if we start understanding our domain and we start understanding what is the problem in our hand. Then we start understanding what is the type of problem or learning style that my machine learning model should have. So if we start understanding in that fashion, our solution will be an effective one, because you cannot apply all algorithms for all problems. Again, it is based on the categorical and the continuous one. Again, it is based on the supervised one and the unsupervised one. So what are the steps in traditional machine learning? Steps in traditional machine learning, okay? Data collection, preparation of a model, training the model, evaluating the model. Then what is this parameter tuning? Then to make predictions, okay? So this is what we see as the steps. So in traditional, what are the steps? So data collection is the first step. What it indicates is the accuracy, okay? The good quantity and quality of data that you have in your hand, it indicates the quality of your model, okay? So how accurate is your model is dependent on how good your quality and quantity of the data are, okay? Again, the data is in table form, 2D form, 3D form. And again, you will collect data from your own problem domain, or you can collect from Kaggle, or you can even do it from UCL. Okay, all these are prominent databases that I have listed. So this data you can always use and refer it, because that is what today's researchers are doing. These data sets have become standards today, and you are trying to explore the performance of all these machine learning algorithms based on the standard data sets. So that is how things are moving on today. So this is about data collection. Then data preparation. This data preparation may not be sufficiently required if you collect it from prominent data sets, but they are very much required if your data sets are from real time, okay? And there is no proper data collection mechanism that you have. So you have to prepare your data so that it suits your machine learning model as such, because the next step is machine learning model. So this step is all about data preparation, which again involves data munging. This is the word that everybody is now talking about, data munging. So discovering, structuring, cleaning, enriching, validating and publishing, all these steps, they do it. So data scientists are being recruited today to do this, because data is now coming in very raw state, and you should collect those raw data or information and then process it, okay? So cleaning is the next aspect. Then you have to randomize the data so that your training goes well in the next phase. Then visualize data for detecting relationships between variables and split into training and evaluation sets. So this training and evaluation sets, what they are, again, I will come into the discussion after this discussion. So traditional steps, there are 7. In this first 2 steps I have discussed. Third step is choosing a model. So here is where you have to apply your machine learning model, choosing a model. Then you have to train the model, because that choosing a model is not the solution, because your machine learning models are all data driven. It is not the algorithm driven approach that is followed in machine learning algorithms, but this data driven approach is being followed where you train your model based on the data sets. So to answer a question, to make a prediction correctly and all, you have to train the model properly. So it goes on in an iteration process that we have discussed at the beginning, okay? Then how do we evaluate the model? So we test the model against previous unseen data. So any discrepancies are there that can be removed. And again, you evaluate the model to understand what is the performance of the model. So evaluate the model. Then parameter tuning. Because you have evaluated the model, you see that there are drawbacks. There is some need for improvement in the performance. So that performance can be done when you start tuning your parameters. So if you look at this machine learning, again, you need to tune the weights and biases that you have so that the performance tuning happens for the machine learning model that you have proposed. Then the next one is all about making predictions. So use the test data to test the model. So you use the test data and you see whether you get the intended results or not, and you start measuring the performance. You start measuring the performance. Okay, nowadays the accuracy is between 99.9 and 99.8, okay? I mean to say, the thing is like it is now based on how admissions are going in IITs, okay? So you miss some click and you are missing a seat in IIT Delhi today. So that is how the thing is today. And the best part of this machine learning techniques and their performance, it is all about how nearer and how good your improvement is. So improvement is on in the basis of 99 and 90. Of course, for few worst case algorithms, machine learning algorithms, you are able to show improvements in the range of 80, 80 to 85. But all the best models that are able to predict their performance ranges, they differ between 95 and 100, not less, okay? So predictions, they are in the range of 95 to 100. That means that this is the accuracy that they are expecting today. Then what are the different data sets used in machine learning? This is one more aspect, because until time I was talking about what is machine learning, what are the different types of data. Here I want to talk about the data sets that I use in machine learning as such. So there is a model, and how do I make that model know that what I want from that model, okay? That means you should have a training data set, you should have a validation data set, and you should have a testing data set. And there is definitely a meaning for all these three. So at the beginning, you use the data, you perform the data examination, and you call those data to be a training data set. So they are the input to your model at the initial stages. Then the next stage is validation data set, where you evaluate the model predictions and make it learn from the mistakes then testing data sets, they map the output quality and accuracy. So testing data sets are nothing but the final evaluation after the training stage. And now your product is ready for deployment, and working accuracy is what depicted in your testing data set. So if you look at a data model, initial stages, it will use training data set and validation data sets. At the end, when it is being deployed, it will be tested with the testing data sets, which will ensure that your your model is working properly. Okay, so this is how things are. One and two, training data sets and validation data sets, they are prior to the deployment of the model. Testing data set is one which you use it after the deployment of the model. Okay. So there is definitely an improvement in the expert machine learning that is being implemented today. It is not the same because they wanted to see that improvement is there in your machine learning. So how to make it an expert machine learning? Okay, so few steps have been changed, where first step is problem and the assessment of the data set. Second one is choosing a measure of success. So you tell that data set is there. How do you tell that you have a complete data set? What is the measure for success? Then deciding an evaluation protocol. So you have to tell when my model is properly done. What is the accuracy level that I have to achieve? It has to clearly specify. Then prepare your data, develop a model, then scaling it up so that it can fit to the best, or it can fit to the big data also. Then regularizing your model and tuning the parameters. So all these are few things that are happening in the current machine learning models. And the marked things in yellow, they are the improvements: choosing a measure of success, deciding an evaluation protocol to test the model, then scaling up for bigger data and developing a model that overfits. So this is what they are looking forward in the expert machine learning. Then coming to the next aspect is evolutionary machine learning, and what are the scope for improvement that they are looking for? Okay, this is one important aspect. Okay, so I was talking about the different steps in machine learning. Then when I again come back to this evolutionary machine learning, what it tells us is you have a machine learning model in hand, and I want to see that my machine learning is gradually improving. That is, my model is gradually improving. So what are all the aspects that I need to look for? That is, what is the scope for improvement in my machine learning model? So it is all based on the training classifiers and the prediction methods, what I can do with them. So there is a scope for improvement in training classifier and the prediction methods that I use in machine learning. So parameter tuning. So there are few parameters which I tune so that my model is becoming more effective. So what shall I tune there? How to tune them? So that is one future aspect of study. Then multiple objectives and how to minimize the multiple objectives is one more study, because having multiple objectives for your machine learning actually reduces the performance and efficiency. Okay, so how to see that your multiple objectives or parameters are reduced? How can be the dimensionality be approximately correlated? Then what is this overfitting and underfitting? How to solve this problem? What is the study that we have to do so that this is improved? Then what is feature selection? So what is feature selection and how can it improve the machine learning? So this is one aspect that I want to discuss in detail in the next coming slides also, because this is very important, and our researchers, if really they want to look into how to improve the performance, okay? Because let me tell you what is there in such a problem, okay? Now let us suppose that you have started your project using OpenCV for face recognition, let us suppose, and you want to see that your model works better, okay? How do you see that your model works better? Now what we do is we try to change one algorithm or technique that I am using in my machine learning model. Then I see what is the output, okay? But that is not good enough, okay? What I have to do is I have to consider all these scope points. When I see that what are the scope points, then I could understand, okay, this algorithm for this model is providing this much level of accuracy. So what I have to change so that my accuracy is improved? What I should do so that my prediction is getting improved? Okay, so this is the first thing that I will discuss. Okay, so training machine learning techniques require optimal parameters, so minimal parameters to perform optical learning and to maximize the classification or prediction accuracy. So you require minimal parameters to make or make your classification or prediction more accurate. Okay, minimal parameters are required. Okay, this is considered as an optimization problem because you need to optimize the parameters as such. Then how do we do that? Because we are not doing this in our machine learning model, and we have to do it well ahead of applying this into our machine learning model, because this prediction methods, training classifiers, they are all part of this. And how to do it? So we go ahead with the gradient based method, and that has been popular there for some time now. And what is the problem is they are suffering, they suffer from local optimal stagnation. So local minima problem is there, and you require large number of parameters for training. Okay, so when I have large number of parameters for training, my prediction accuracy is reduced, my training efforts are increased, overall efficiency is decreased, all these things they happen. So few gradient based methods are also becoming popular, so that your training and prediction are becoming more and more effective. So our researchers, they can make their training and prediction, if they have a problem in their research, then you can go and see what are these gradient based methods, and they of course are few heuristic methods as such that can be applied. Okay, then the next parameter, next thing is parameter tuning. Okay, next one is the parameter tuning. Okay, so what they do is they improve the performance of the model. Okay, so if you have more and more parameters, actually they try to reduce the performance. So controlling parameters themselves need to be optimized for training neural networks, and you have two parameters in case of neural networks. One is the learning rate and the momentum. So you need to apply the heuristic methods to tune them, and you need to see how a learning rate can be improved, and you can see how your momentum can be improved. So what type of filters can be applied, so that and all can be looked forward. Okay, then the next one is multiple objectives. So you, in case of some problems, you will see that there are more variables that are involved, and our objective is to minimize the error that is there in my solution. Okay, so for that, what we need to do is we need to see that multiple objectives, they can be aggregated into some set of weights. So multiple objectives, they need to be aggregated into one weight. Okay, and a multi-objective AI search or optimization algorithm can be used to solve. So here, reduction of the parameters is objective is not the solution, but what is being done here is, how can you see that multiple objectives can be aggregated into set of weights, so that you can map them into one singular weight, and you can see how problem can be solved further. Okay, then what is this problem of overfitting or underfitting? Okay, so these are two issues that we commonly face in machine learning. And what is this overfitting is, like, it captures the noise in the data, and when machine learning technique is too flexible, what happens is it learns not only the problem in hand, it not only the pattern of the problem, but also the noise. So what happens when you start learning the noise is something like your solution will not be very much accurate. Okay, because you should try to eliminate your noise when you are starting to learn, because your system is too flexible learning all these things, noise, including noise. So this problem is coming into picture. Then what is this underfitting? So this occurs when the machine learning technique is very rigid and it cannot learn the underlying pattern itself. So when it doesn't learn the pattern itself, there is no point. Okay, so this results in underfitting, where it is not able to identify the exact solution for the inputs that you have given. Okay, so the next category is both overfitting and underfitting. They are not desirable in your problem. So you have to have a right balance in your machine learning model, so that these conflicts never arise. Okay, so this is one more area of research to ensure overfitting and underfitting doesn't happen. So again, you can have one more program written by you so that overfitting or underfitting doesn't happen in your problem itself. Then what is feature selection? Okay. So it is common issue in the machine learning in the existence of large number of features. When you have more features relevant to your representation, how to see that those features are reduced? Okay, because if you have more and more features, what happens is your classification problem becomes difficult and your prediction accuracy is getting reduced. Okay. So some features might be reduced and they might be redundant also. See that they are eliminated. Okay. An optimal set of features should be considered. So these are all the different aspects, evolutionary aspects of machine learning that research can go on. Research is going on and will go on also, because if you try to improve these aspects, the accuracy and prediction of the machine learning models are improved. Then the next point of discussion is on what are the machine learning domains and what are the machine learning models that are suitable. Okay, for supervised you have classification and regression types. For unsupervised you have dimensionality reduction and clustering. For reinforcement you have one category. So for classification type, you can solve problems or the fraud detection problem, email spam detection problem, computer diagnostics, image classification problem. They come under the classification problem of supervised learning. So some researchers who are now looking at this slide, they should be understanding what is my problem in hand and which type of machine learning can be applied. Okay, so we need not waste our time much in understanding where my problem is, what I have to do. Just look at such tables and understand. Because if you look at today's domain, okay, they are rather simplified. One is based on the image, the another one is based on voice or text. So these are the two domains that we have, and we are trying to apply as many as technologies that are required. Then, this variables, what are continuous variables and what are categorical variables? This I have already discussed. Okay. Then algorithm and application domain. So what is this continuous variable and what is this categorical variable? A continuous variable has value in the sense like numbers 1, 2, 3, and they have some magnitude. Okay, magnitude is of importance in continuous variables. Categorical variables, they have function, they has values that function as labels rather than numbers. Okay, they may not have so many values associated with them, but they will have few categories. So categorical and continuous. Continuous variables, they have range of values. Categorical variables, they have less range of values. Okay. So supervised learning, it can solve continuous variable type problem, categorical type problem. Similarly, unsupervised, and again, similarly, reinforcement. What they can do is they can apply in turn different types of machine learning techniques to solve different problems. So house price prediction, then medical imaging, then customer segmentation, market basket analysis, text classification, then lane finding on GPS data, then optimized marketing and driverless cars. So all these are the problems, and you can understand what is that we can do with this. Okay. So again, there is one thing that I have introduced here in this, of course, in the sense in this figure, is about the semi-supervised learning, where you have huge amounts of data and you have a collection of those with labels and without labels. And those with labels will help you in guiding those without labels and then cluster them. Okay, so there is the need again for a semi-supervised learning model. Again, common applications and domains of machine learning. This is also equally important. Manufacturing, retail, healthcare, travel and hospitality, financial services, then stock, energy, and other utilities. So for all these domains, you have so many problems. Many of our researchers, young researchers, may have all these problems in mind. So they can just start looking into what are the different domains of machine learning problems that are there in hand and how we can solve them. Okay. Then, evolving applications. What new applications are coming into picture? Of course, I will share all these slides. Okay, I will share all these slides once it is done. So, machine learning algorithms. How they are currently being diversified from machine learning, supervised and unsupervised and reinforced. And again, from unsupervised, you have dimensionality reduction that you do. You have clustering that you do. Supervised, you have classification that you do and regression that you do. What types of problems are solved by regression? What types of problems are solved by classification? So it all again depends on whether your data is continuous or categorical. Okay, so it is all dependent on that. Then, what are the evolving machine learning algorithms and relationship? So this again, it is the next level. This is again the next level of your problem. Then what are the popular machine learning platforms and tools that we have? So scikit-learn, PyTorch, TensorFlow, Keras, Weka. Weka is very primitive one. Okay. So what they actually do? So scikit-learn, what algorithm or features are present, because you cannot break your head sitting in front of a scikit-learn and try to solve one unknown algorithm of machine learning. Okay, so I want to solve some reinforcement learning problem. There is no point sitting in front of scikit-learn. So again, TensorFlow, again, this is one buzzword today. All problems machine learning, they approach this TensorFlow, including the deep learning model. It approaches the TensorFlow. Then Keras is one other such platform. It is also very much suitable for neural networks. Then Weka. So these are all the popular platforms that can be used today or use it today. So NIME, Colab from Google, then Apache, Mahout, then .NET, it provide some support, Shogun. So all these are the different problems, algorithms, and platforms. What is the language that you can use? C++, Java, Python. So these are all the prominent languages, okay? So our next topic of discussion is about our interesting applications, social networking applications, how they are using all this machine learning in place, how they are using this machine learning, to what extent, what algorithm is being used. Okay, now this is from the perspective of few of our faculty friends who are very much interested in knowing how is our Facebook running. Okay, so no doubt our Facebook is running on a graph based data structure, so it is the skeleton. And on top of that, definitely it uses the machine learning to tell you who are your friends, okay? Who are the suggested friends, okay? So definitely apart from your graph theory and the suitable thing, you have an application called facial recognition, okay? So you have to see that your tag suggestions and face recognition to be turned on, so that what your machine learning in Facebook will do is it will start identifying you in your friends' images or pictures that have been uploaded. Similarly, you have uploaded your image along with your friend's image, then again it starts tagging those things, tagging your friends. So this is how it starts identifying people using the facial recognition. Okay, so a deep face algorithm was developed, okay, by Facebook, and it uses that particular model. So it is a proprietary one. Okay, then textual analysis. For textual analysis, Facebook again uses a deep text model. Okay, then deep text, it uses again a deep learning style for its machine learning model. Again, it handles labeled data much more efficiently than the traditional natural language processing. So textual analysis is again done through deep learning model. Then targeted advertising. So we generally shop in Flipkart. We generally shop in Myntra or any other shopping portal. Then we suddenly log into our Facebook page. They again start showing the ads, okay? They show ads related to the items that you have looked for or moved to your cart in your Flipkart or Amazon, okay? So it is all quite possible. And again, your Facebook uses the data that you have in your browsers, okay? So a deep neural network model is in place. Deep learning model is in place so that it identifies your age, gender, location, page likes from your browser, the interest that you have, all these things, okay? Some of people, they watch movies, okay, on Netflix. And again, that Netflix, it starts suggesting similar movies on the go. So it is all based on the machine learning model that you use, okay? But currently, Facebook is having its own model, okay? So the language translation. So deep text is the language translation model that is being used. And the language translation happens from any language to any language without any intermediate language. So A to B, if I have a translation, then again, it need not go to some common language called English or Telugu or something, because it is mother tongue for you, but not for Facebook, okay? So deep text comes into picture and it starts translation, okay? Then news feed. So the rank of anything that appears in your news feed is decided on three factors: your friends, family, and public figures or business that you interact, okay? So if you are interacting more, like if you are watching news and you are more likely listening to speeches from Narendra Modi, yes, of course, you will be tagged to him, okay? And whatever are the updates or feeds from him, it will reach you. And a deep face project, what Facebook does for face recognition. This deep face is the model, and it is achieving a accuracy of nearly 97.25. So it is the deep learning model that is being used. And how it works is, it is basically a two-step process. So it aligns the face of a person that you have posted his picture on the Facebook using a 3D model, and forward-looking face is considered, and it considers points, okay? Points on the face. Then second step is, it uses deep learning to find out numerical description of forward-looking face along with the other directions. So if two different images have similar descriptions, then it matches to you and it tells that it is the same person. So first step is like it aligns your face and creates the points. Then second step is like you have the aligned face mapped with the other faces of the image using deep learning. Then it tries to identify whether it is the same person that it has taken forward, okay, at the beginning. So outline of this deep face architecture, how it happens. A front end single convolutional pooling happens, then convolutional filtering happens. Then it is followed by three locally connected layers of fully connected layers. So this is how the steps happen in your Facebook. So deep text, how Facebook understands text. So deep text uses unsupervised machine learning to interpret the meaning of posts and comments. It again understands your comments, which is very important to know, okay? Then it translates in more than 20 languages. Then deep text teaches itself with large unlabeled data sets. So you need not have to make it learn. It learns automatically with the new words by itself. So it improves the vocabulary by itself. So deep text is programmed to learn observing how people communicate. So you need not have to interfere in between. So the targeted advertisements, how advertisements are coming onto your page. So it is based on the location data. It is based on the mouse movements that you do on your page. And what are all the connected applications that you have? Because now Facebook has taken up WhatsApp and Instagram, and it is able to collect data from all these media and reflect what are your interests on your Facebook, okay? So now this is going to be the next biggest market where people are floated with advertisements on your WhatsApp. Okay, next it may be the case. You keep on watching something on your Facebook, or you keep on watching something on your Flipkart, automatically it will be captured by Facebook, automatically it will come to your WhatsApp tomorrow. We still believe that WhatsApp messages, we feel like today intended messages will come. Tomorrow unintended messages will come, where you have to block for that also. Language translation. So 100 languages are currently being under research for translation. So there is one community called Facebook AI Research Community. That is one advanced community that is there in place. So what is happening in that AI Facebook page? So computer vision, conversational AI, integrity, natural language processing research, ranking and recommendation research, system research, then speech and audio, human and machine intelligence, and other areas. Now, this I wanted to showcase because we are very much interested on the front page of the Facebook, not behind page or the AI page. So I wanted this our people to be knowing about this. Okay. And the Google AI, so he is the leader today, and and he has got his own platform. No doubt Google has got hundreds and hundreds of apps inside, but AI is his backbench, okay, back brain. So I want to share that page again. So Google's AI page, so cloud.google.com AI platform. So what features it support we have. And it is not free. It is having some pricing, of course. So, and who are the customers, what they do. So this is one Google Cloud AI page. Okay. So this is where Google does its AI and AI business. Okay. So what are the features supported by Google AI? Because we need to understand what are the tools that are supported by Google AI. Of course, these are all open source. Okay, this is an open source thing, but AutoML, what it does, it is one platform where you develop high quality custom machine learning models without writing training routines. Okay, so this is powered by Google state of the art transfer learning and hyperparameter search technology. Now, why I want to discuss about all these things is we need not sit and scratch our head thinking like, oh, I need to know all these things, then only I can start developing something using machine learning. Not required. There are so many models in the market today which are open, which are available. What we need to do is we need to take them, dig deep, understand how it works, then understand what you need to do so that it works according to you. Okay, so this is what we need to look into. All these are open. Then continuous evaluation. So it is about the metrics of performance of models in production. Then data labeling service. So again, data that it provides to you is again labeled and supplied to you. So this is what is the feature. Then feature support by Google AI. What are the other features? Deep learning containers. So containerization is the aspect. So you have a container with deep learning models, you go and quickly build and deploy models. Okay, deep learning VMware, that is VM image. So virtualization is one more topic that it supports. Then TensorFlow enterprise version is available. Then a visualizer, Vizier, optimize your models output by intelligently tuning hyperparameters. So all these are the features that are available. Okay. Now these features have got their own prominence when you people start working on different types of models and what are the different services you are expecting. Okay, again, deep learning containers are there today where you need not have a space. You have you have to take this space from this deep learning container and you start developing your models there. Then how YouTube uses this machine learning, okay? So we all know that for every one day in US, they are uploading nearly 400 hours of content into the YouTube, okay? And earlier it used a matrix factorization method to identify the relevant videos that can be suggested, YouTube videos that can be suggested to the user. That is the recommendation system that was being used, matrix factorization method. And currently it has been modified or changed to a deep neural network model for recommendation. So it is again taken up, that is deep neural network again is backbone, and that backbone is taking up a two-stage model to retrieve your video and put it in front of 1 minute and 1 minute. A deep neural network model is used as a recommender system today, okay? So how it functions? So it functions like this. You have a two-stage model. One is the candidate generation. As soon as you enter your text, it goes and generates the candidate generation. The next one is the ranking model. That ranking model will tell you what are the exact candidates of video that you are looking for. Again, this is based on a machine learning approach only. It is again based on the deep learning model only. Then how YouTube uses machine learning in other cases? What are the other aspects? We simply feel like only the aspect of recommending your videos is the only job that the YouTube has to do with machine learning. No. It has to do automatic removal of objectionable contents, because 70% of the contents are objectionable content that you post on your YouTube, and that has to be removed. So that is now currently being removed by machine learning models only. Then new effects on videos. So you upload videos and you want to beautify it, okay? So that beautifying of your background again is undertaken by this aspect of machine learning. Then up next feature is the recommendation. That recommendation is again by the machine learning model. Then mass shootings and plaguing were happening in America, and they were understanding like which person or a person viewing at this type of videos is more prone to shooting, okay? So he is more he is going to perform mass shooting, he is going to be an antisocial element, a terrorist kind of stuff. So that and all were the predictions that YouTube is doing today, so that it eases its job as well as the job of the nation, okay? So this is what YouTube is going or it is doing as part of machine learning aspects, okay? So there are many aspects that this machine learning is doing with several applications. Again, YouTube with the Twitter. Oh, so you know people tweet and it is done. No, it is where sentiment analysis is done. It is where much of social listening is done. And it involves how media is playing, okay? How media is doing things today. So I need not talk about how our politicians are taking into account of all these Twitters and making benefit of their own. And again, how world politics is moving around, okay? Oh, so definitely today you could have observed that the Prime Minister of Britain is being invited for the Republic Day, okay? So it doesn't mean much to us, okay, but it means much to the people of USA, and it means much to the people of People's Republic of China, okay? because he is one such element now whom we go nearer, and we are going nearer to the USA. Okay, so he is one such link now who takes us nearer to the US, because there is no other country who has completely identified the presidential election and who has recognized the presidential election in USA. So we are going nearer, and it matters much. Okay, so this is just an example. Okay, maybe unreal thing, but next few days we will come to know why we are inviting him and why. Basically, if you look at okay, we are inviting today the Prime Minister of UK, and he is coming. We feel like only we invited him and he is coming. It is not like that. No other Prime Minister or President is willing to come to India because of this pandemic. Okay, so he is coming today and we are inviting him. But if you look at the background of that, there is much more things that are happening, and Twitter is doing its own tricks. Okay, so you feel like Twitter is not doing anything, but you can just collect the data from the Twitter and you can do an analyze what is happening. So that feature is available. You can dig into tweets and then you can perform whatever analysis you want to do. And how Amazon uses this machine learning. So personalized offers, discounts, it is only for you, okay, not for others. So it is decided by machine learning. Then customer potential or loyalty, repeating buyers, how does it analyze? Again, using machine learning. Inventory demand forecasting, again, it is done by machine learning, okay. Then product pricing, then merchandising analytics, again, it is done by. So I want to highlight the facts where and all we have open scope for research, okay. When machine learning is playing such a vital role in Amazon, why can't it play a major role in your own business? Okay, so you need not do it at such a big thing, okay, such a big stage for Amazon or other persons, okay, but you can do it, or you can build your own model which can fit for so many. I can tell you one example, okay. So when I was a graduate, okay, when I was a graduate, maybe I graduated from engineering in year 2000, okay. So what I understood is many smaller firms, they wanted a web application where they can market their own items. So after that, I could see that Flipkart, so many things, of course, they came up after that, okay. So such things, they happen, they came into reality. We don't know tomorrow, there will be a prominent model like whatever we have a e-commerce website, we have a prominent model for machine learning where we people go and subscribe. Our website will be there and we go and subscribe to that machine learning model. So that machine learning model will provide the all these details. So whatever is required for your marketing, it will provide marketing solutions. It will provide digital marketing solutions. It will provide so many other solutions it can provide. Okay, so we can aim at such projects in the future. So all our young researchers, they can look at such models, a generalized model where you act as a service provider, and all people or all websites, they take up your service. Instead of developing your own model, you can look up for generalizing such things. For one business, you can have one general model. Real estate, one model, machine learning model. Then grocery, one machine learning model. Then clothes, one machine learning model. So that you can, we can look into, and we can start building individual models, and so many other subscribers can be there. So what they have to do is they have to link up with your service and use it. So promotion effectiveness, then market mix analysis, sales volume decomposition, all those things, they can be part of this very much, okay, Amazon. Then Kaggle is one aspect, okay. So what this Kaggle is, it is a subsidiary of Google, and it is an online community of scientists and machine learning practitioners. Okay, now Google is managing this Kaggle. Okay, so what they do there, okay, they publish data sets, they explore building models, then they work with other data scientists, then they enter competitions to solve data science challenges. Okay, so I will go to that site where Kaggle is currently, what Kaggle is doing. Okay, okay, so this is the Kaggle page. Okay, so there are competitions, then there are data sets, there are notebooks, there are communities, there are courses for newbies. So what these notebooks will have is they will have all the solved problems along with the code. Okay, I can go to one particular item where I could see code as well. Okay, so this is the code, this is the problem, this is the problem, some problem is there, there you have some code, you can start working on that. So what you can do, or a researcher can do, is start looking at these problems and try to understand how they work. Okay, again, compete is one important aspect. Okay, so these are all the open problems, and this is the amount that they are willing to pay. You participate and you can win that. Okay, so these are the competitions. So like hackathons, codeathons and all, you have a machine learning model building platform, competition platform, where you can participate. Okay, so answer correctness prediction, then street market prediction, then big data bowl. So all these are the different problems. Okay, problems, prize money. As soon as that problem is solved, it will go to the completed state. So you can see what they have done, who has won it, along with the code. Of course, you have the code also. Notebooks will have the code. So all this code is there. So these are all the participants for solving the problem, and you have a code. Working code, not working code, so many aspects are there. Okay, so this is what Kaggle has to do with the researchers. And what Kaggle does is supports competitions, supports a cloud-based workbench for data science and machine learning developers. Then it provides a public data set platform, and it supports Kaggle Learn for short form of AI. So you have all these pandas tutorials, etc., etc., all these deep learning tutorials, machine learning tutorials. So it is one end-to-end solution, from learning to a graduate to earning. Okay, so even an entrepreneur, he can post his problem. If an entrepreneur can propose a solution, again he can do it. Developer can propose a solution. So everything is possible. Okay, it provides or acts as a platform, and currently it is supported by Google. Okay. Now, yes, sir.
So hello. Sorry to interrupt, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, 15 minutes break usually we use.
Sir, I can close this in 5 or 10 minutes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Sir. Yes, sir. I can close this because some meeting is there. I can close it, sir. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So the other aspect is about Microsoft. Previously, I was discussing about how Google was doing. Okay, the other competitor is Microsoft. He has his own edge in on AI. Okay, so TensorFlow is now under GitHub as a project. Scikit-learn is under a project in GitHub. Quicks Prediction IO. So all these projects are now there with GitHub. Okay. Then there is one new aspect of no code machine learning platforms. So what it happens is all we will be dreaming about, or what we'll be thinking about machine learning is, okay, I have to code, I have to do all these are little bit hectic stuff. So for those who can understand code, yes, platforms are available. Okay, but for those who do not want to code, there are few platforms as well. So you have to select a model, give the inputs, then train your model with the data, because training your model is the key. So that it is possible with a few of these models, no code machine learning platforms. These platforms can help you. Core ML, Google Auto ML, Make ML, then Fritz AI. So all these are the no code platforms. All these are the no code platforms that can help you in coding. Help you in designing machine learning models without code. Okay. So this is what was my discussion. And chatbots is the next thing. Goal-oriented chatbot and general conversation chatbots. And again, all these, they are now using deep learning, okay? So this is how I was planning to finish, okay? But one aspect that I look forward is RPA, robotic process automation, in concurrency with your deep learning. Definitely it makes sense that it will go forward miles, okay? So this is what I could see some future, okay? Our students can also take up projects on RPA. Then similarly, they can start using your machine learning as well, okay? Okay, so with this, I can finish my session, and a few questions may be welcome, sir.
Yeah, I request participants so that you can raise your hand. You can talk to the professor if you have any doubts or anything else. You can raise your hand, participant, so that I'll help you to unmute yourself. I guess there are no questions, sir.
Sir, thank you, sir. And I am in some meeting. I am planning for a meeting.
Sir,
I can share.
Thank you, sir. Sir, they have one raised hand is there.
Yes,
please.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Nitya, madam, you can unmute yourself, madam.
Madam, am I audible, ma'am?
I have a small doubt, sir. Actually, I am from the domain of management.
Okay.
And I have a background of statistics under undergraduation and post-graduation. So can I pursue my postdoctoral fellowship in any project with the application of machine learning? Is that possible?
Yeah, madam. You can always go ahead towards business intelligence, business systems. So that domain will help you, and you need to have a background of probability and statistics. So I feel that will definitely help you in moving forward and taking up things. And you have few platforms where you can use no code type of models. That will be always useful for you.
Okay.
Even for HR, if I can comment, okay. Even for HR, now they are using ML to predict the sustainability and retention of the employee. All these things now they are looking at ML, okay. They are looking at AI and ML.
Okay, sir. And one other doubt, sir.
Yeah.
I'm in the journey of learning machine learning, but I find deep learning to be much ahead, over my head. So I have an intention to stop with the ML, machine learning algorithm alone. Will that be a right decision? That is my question.
Yeah, my suggestion will be like you should have a brief idea about machine learning and what are the things, what are the problems. Then you go with the deep learning, okay? So it is one separate chain where it is dependent on the neural networks, and it is not based on the data category, okay? It is not based on the data category, but it is based on how your neural network will take up the problems. So speech, it handles in one way. Image, it handles it in another way. So so different networks are there which can handle different types of problems. So it is little bit required to have fundamentals from machine learning, but it is a subdomain where you have neural networks to be the fundamental.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, sir. Thank you for your valuable knowledge sharing, sir. Thank you. So I think I'll not disturb you more because you have a meet.
Sir, have a meet 4:30, sir. But sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah, dear participants, we We are very glad that we have a consistency of 60 to 75 participants throughout this FDP session for all 2 weeks. So we are happy with that. So I request any participants to please kindly share your feedback. So anyone is fine. So that if you can raise hand, I'll help you to unmute so that you can share your valuable feedback with us. So it will be helpful for us to again overcome those things in my other slot too. So we are starting it from Monday on 7th of December, sir. Karunendra, sir, please, sir. Sir, you can unmute yourself, sir. Karunendra Verma, sir. Sir, Karunendra, sir, you can unmute yourself, sir. Sir, you can unmute yourself and speak, sir. No problem, sir. Karunendra, sir. Karunendra, sir, you can unmute yourself and speak, sir. No problem, sir. Yeah, Nitya, madam. Please, madam. Nitya, madam, you can unmute yourself, madam.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yes, madam, you're audible, madam.
Yes, sir. I'm Dr. Nitya from Sonau College of Technology from Tamil Nadu. So, madam. No, amid our college schedule, I'm just, you know, keenly observing this. Already I am in the learning stage of this ML. And basically, I always found this Python when hands-on experience, though we are not able to work parallelly.
Yeah.
The video that you have shared to our personal email, it was very useful. And I used that twice also for certain terms. So I find this FDP very different in terms of sharing the videos immediately after the session. So that was highly useful, because while handling programming, coding, all that stuff, it is really useful for us to immediately look upon the source files. So in that way,
madam, it is really possible because of our team member, Dr. Veeramanikyam, sir. So he has been collecting all those videos and he's always posting it in the Google Classroom and sharing it with everyone. So he is the one beside helping all those, sharing all those videos with all the participants. I think even I thank Dr. Veeramanikyam, sir.
Yeah,
and we have
concerned person. True.
Yeah, he's very concerned about all this. So he's sorting all these things and is giving a timely help to all the participants. True, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So like even we have one more. Yes, madam. We have one more coordinator, Dr. Shanmugnathan, sir. So sir is also preparing all these assessment exams, all the other things necessary from the speakers. And we are always, we are always towards participants. What do the participants need? So we are always taking care of that. And I think your support will again be with us for the forthcoming events also.
We thank have you, passed the message to our other colleagues also. They are also willing to join this in the second batch.
Please tell them to join in the slot to otherwise, madam. We have actually closed it. But again, we will help them to join in slot 2 if they are fine and convenient.
So the first and foremost credit on this. And second one, the choice of resource person were awesome. And we really felt like, you know, teaching a children from the scratch. So that attempt was also appreciable and commended.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. And even our management has also supported us very much. Even our principal, our chairman, sir, Dr. Vishnu Raj Garu, and our principal, sir, Dr. G. Srinivas Rao, and the convener of this event, Dr. D.V. Nagaraj Garu, and our former HOD, Dr. Venkat Ramaraj Garu. So everyone of them has supported us from the back end. So who are all not there in the picture right now, but they have supported very much to go ahead with all the speakers and give the participants what do they really need. So our team, I mean, along with me, all the other team has also, I think we have reached a certain level. So we'll still work more to again go to the next level and give the necessary things in our next slot too also, madam. So I think your continuous support will be there with us, not only you also, madam, with all the participants, so whom I cannot call name by name. We really very thankful to all of you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. And
thank you, madam. Sir, if anyone others also, if they like to talk, they can raise your hand, sir. I'll help them to unmute. Veeramadikam, sir, if you can, if you want to speak some words, you can unmute yourself and speak, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind feedback. Thank you all the participants for consistency in your involvement in attending the all the sessions. Thank you very much.
The participants today, feedback link will be shared again through the WhatsApp through our team to you, so you can complete the feedback. And a small assessment test is being conducted today, so it will have some 20 to 30 questions depending on this 1-2 week faculty development program only on data science using Python. So there will be some basic questions regarding the talk which the experts have given to us, so you can complete the assessment test also. So once you have completed the assessment test, so we will be sharing the certificates to you. I think there is a sir Veeramadikam, sir, is there 60% sir or 80% cutoff? How much do we have, sir?
80% cutoff attendance we are required, but we okay. will consider a few requests based on their college activity related issues. So okay. we will intimate all the things within a week about your processing of this certificate.
Yeah, so exam, it will be of 1 hour, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
40 questions, 1 hour.
Okay, so exam will be, the assessment link will be shared to you participants. So it will be for 40 questions, so it will be for 1 hour. So we request you to kindly complete the assessment also. It is a compulsory activity, so along with the feedback which you are doing it daily. So once you finish these both, so we'll compile everything and we will send the certificates to your mail IDs. So it will take other 7 days to 10 days. But within 7 days, we'll ensure that each and every participant who has attended the FDP with our required criteria will be, the certificate will be definitely shared to you. There is no other issue. But in case if you have any query or any question regarding this, you can please mail us or you can even WhatsApp us so that we'll help you out. So if any question, if any queries or anything required from us, you can please raise your hand. I'll be helping you to answer out. So if any participant has any query or anything else, you can please raise your hand so that I'll help you to unmute and talk. Yeah. Yeah, FDP 1162. You can unmute yourself, please. Yeah, FDP 1162. Yeah, you can unmute yourself and please speak, sir. Yeah, FDP 1162 ID. Please. Sir or madam, you can please unmute yourself and you can speak, sir, if you have any query. Or if anything is required, you can personally write to us also, sir. You can please mail us so that we'll be reverting to you back very soon. So the certificates will be issued within 7 to 10 days. So for getting the certificates, you need to, we'll compile the attendance. And after that, this assessment is also very much required. So once you complete the assessment and all the other attendance forms are being compiled, so we'll segregate them and we'll combine together and we'll issue the certificates in a face-by-face manner. So within 7 to 10 days, within 10 days, we will issue the certificates to your mail IDs. If anything is there, you can please write to us, sir. So I think with this, we'll wind up the session, sir. We thank each and every participant personally for attending all the sessions. So in these 2 weeks, very patiently. So thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So if anything is there, you can please raise your hand. Otherwise, I'll close the session, sir.
Participant, today feedback form is a combined form, including today's feedback and overall feedback. Thank you.
Yeah, Jitendra, sir, you can unmute yourself, sir. Jitendra, sir, you can unmute yourself and speak, sir. There is a raised hand from you. You can unmute yourself and speak, sir. Jitendra Dharji, sir.
Yes, sir. Assessment is provided in WhatsApp group, sir?
Yeah, it will be. The link is provided in the WhatsApp group, sir. We'll share it to you in another 5 to 10 minutes, sir.
Okay, so is there any sessions, sir?
I did not get you, sir.
Okay, sir.
So, no, I did not get you, sir. What, sir?
Sir, is there any session after?
No, there is no session, sir. There is no session. So okay. We are done for the day.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So any other queries, participants? Okay. Thank you, sir. So each and every part. Yeah, we have one more. Abhishek Mahajan. Yeah, please, sir, you can unmute yourself. Sri Vaishnavi madam also, you can, sir, unmute yourself and speak. Yeah, sir.
Can you share the PPTs of the all the sessions?
Yeah, we'll share, sir. We'll definitely share, sir. But I think some other speakers are busy with their daily activities. So I'll talk with them and I'll definitely get all the PPTs and share the drive link to all the participants. There is no issue, sir. We'll ensure that you will get those.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sri Vaishnavi, madam, you can unmute yourself. Sri Vaishnavi, madam, you can unmute yourself and speak, madam. Sri Vaishnavi, madam, I think we have one more. Madam, you can unmute, madam. Sri Vaishnavi, madam, you can unmute yourself and speak, madam. No problem. Sri Vaishnavi, madam, you can unmute, madam, and speak. We have given you the permission. Or, madam, if it is fine, you can personally write to us or over WhatsApp also, it is fine. No problem, madam. We'll revert to you back. So thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So we'll wind up today and we will do accordingly what we have. I think our team will share the feedback link and the assessment link. I think it is the same for today. So both of them, it will be shared to you over WhatsApp. Yeah. Thank you, participants. Thank you very much.
Sir.
Sir. Thank you, sir.
Participant, assessment link is separate.
Oh, I'm sorry, sir.
Actually, feedback form is a combined feedback form. Overall feedback for FDP and today's feedback form.
Okay.
Together.
Okay.
So overall feedback you want to give about FDP, that is also included in the today's feedback form. That is a combined one, single feedback form, including today's attendance. Then assessment link is separate. Both will be shared now. We will close everything by 6 o'clock. Right now, I'll share both of the link.
So participants, please kindly take the exam and the feedback also before 6 o'clock, as our sir suggested to you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you, participants. Thank you very much.